Thank you. Good morning, everybody. All right, everybody hold your breath, pull down your mask. I want to see your smiling faces because I'm really scared right now. Good. Okay. When you just see eyes, it's like one of those claymations where it's just these eyes looking at you. It makes me scared. Anyway, we're so glad you could be here today. We have a special guest speaker today, Stan Leach. And I asked him how he wanted to be introduced, and he said, well, mainly as a grandfather of 7 grandkids. He's also the executive director of Evangelical Friends Missions. I love missions. Do you love missions? It's the heartbeat of Jesus for our world. So I'm excited to hear from him today. Thank you to the band that worked really hard, and it's beautiful. Be Thou My Vision, that last song, if you don't know, is one of the oldest songs that we actually know the author of. I don't know the author's name, but I mean, it was a guy from Ireland that wrote that, and it's like 1300 or 1400 years old, and we still sing those lyrics. So I think that's just pretty amazing. I love that beautiful chorus. We have a few things. First of all, welcome, all of you that are online today. You're so smart, in your jammies with your coffee, hanging out at home. We all dragged ourselves out here, but no. We love you and bless you, including my wife, who's a little bit has a cold today. So anyway, we're so glad you joined us. We just wanted to make a few things noted today, and I'm going to run through them really quick. You see all the dates and times, but the Global Outreach Committee meeting is coming up this week. You can see the details there. Take a picture with your camera on your phone. And then the next thing is the Margaret Fell Friends Women are gathering on the Zoom. Hey, I just saw that lady playing the flute. That's pretty amazing. Anyway, and the third one is Friends Women Shine Retreat that's coming up. So these are all some spectacular things that are going to be happening. I wanted to also make those that are parents let you know that now we're going to be exiting through this door over here. We started last Sunday. We're going to keep that going. So bring your kids down or over, and they'll go out through these doors today after worship. And Bill's going to dismiss them, and they'll go out that way for today. I wanted to just read one little psalm. I love what it says. I lift my eyes to you, O God, enthroned in heaven. We keep looking to the Lord our God for his mercy, just as a servant keeps their eyes on their master, as a slave girl watches her mistress for the slightest signal. Have mercy on us, Lord, have mercy, for we have had our fill of contempt. We have had more than our fill of the scoffing of the proud and the contempt of the arrogant. I remember only one time in life I was able to go to one of those restaurants where each person has an attendant. And we're sitting there. Each of us at the table had our own personal attendant. And it was really weird in a way because I'm sitting there and if I reach for anything, like I just took one sip of my water, right? Put it back down and they're there. And they're watching and watching. I'm like, this is how really rich people have to put up with all the time, that's crazy. But the Lord says that that's the way we're supposed to be in our relationship with the Lord, that we're there, we're attending to him, we're attending to his call on our lives. It says, we keep looking to the Lord our God for his mercy. So I encourage you today, even as we continue in worship, keep looking to the Lord for his mercy in your lives. We have a good report today from Howard. Howard is actually breathing his own oxygen. He's in his room. They've taken off the oxygen, and he's breathing the open air, and that's a wonderful thing. If you didn't know this week that he was, he's still in the ICU, but he had really serious complications going on, but God has been touching him, and we're so excited about that, to hear that report. Does anyone here have a physical need today? You just raise your hand if you want prayer for physical need. Why don't you stand? And we're just going to pray even now as we start this service for you that the Lord would touch you. Anyone here? Okay, I'm sure we all know people that have physical needs going on in their bodies. If you would stand for someone, if you could stand in someone's place today that you know has a physical, that needs a touch from the Lord. We know God's, one of his names is, he is our healer, and we still believe that he heals today. And medicine's amazing, and the things that
doctors can do, but we have a great physician who touches us. So today, would you join me in prayer? Let's pray over these. Lord, we thank you today that we can bring our cares to you. We cast our cares upon you because you care for us, Lord. We thank you that you are our healer, Lord. Yes, there are amazing doctors, there's medicine, there's things that can help. But Lord, we also thank you that you are a great physician. And we look to you just as the waiter would look to the one they're waiting on, Lord. We look to you today. You are our healer. You are the one that provides the miracle of life, Lord. You give us life. I pray in every situation, every person that's represented, God, would you come in that room? Would you come in that place right now? Touch them, Lord. Who do we have in heaven but you, and who on the earth but our God? So we look to you. We trust in you. We pray for a great report, Lord. We pray for sickness to be healed in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. You were wounded for our transgressions. You were bruised for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was laid on you, and by your stripes we are healed. So we thank you for that today, Jesus. And we pray by faith, believing. Thank you, Lord. Amen. God bless you. Everyone else can join them standing up. And turn and wave and greet or say hi. And you got like 30 seconds before we start worship.
Have you stand again in a minute, but for now, please be seated. I want to say shalom to everyone. And before we begin singing this morning, I want to take us back to Bible times, when every year Jews traveled to Jerusalem for one of the three main annual Jewish festivals. The city of Jerusalem is situated on a high hill, and as they traveled, they traditionally sang songs on the ascent on a high hill as they traveled. Psalm 120 to 135 contain these songs of ascent or pilgrim songs. For example, they sang from Psalm 121, "I will lift up my eyes to the mountains. From whence shall my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth." And from Psalm 125, "Those who trust in the Lord are as Mount Zion, which cannot be moved, but abides forever. As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people from this time forth and forever." Zion is the mountain on which the first city of Jerusalem was built, and often used as another name for Jerusalem. In the New Testament, we're told that there's a heavenly city to which believers in Jesus are traveling. Hebrews 12 says, "You have come to Mount Zion, to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem." And in Hebrews 13, we read, "For here we do not have a lasting city, but we are seeking the city which is to come." Through Jesus, then, let us continually offer up a sacrifice of praise to God, that is, the fruit of lips that give thanks to his name. Our opening song today is an old, old one that many of you will know, written by Isaac Watts. It contains pilgrimage imagery and is a call to worship in which the children of God call to one another to join in the journey to the heavenly Jerusalem. So let's stand up again and raise our voices with one accord in our joy and eagerness to worship our heavenly King.
Come, we that love the Lord, and let our joys join in a song with sweet accord. Surround the throne, and thus surround the throne. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. Let those refuse to sing who never knew our God, the children of the heavenly King, the children of the heavenly King. May speak their joys abroad, may speak their joys abroad. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. The hill of Zion yields a thousand sacred sweets. Before we reach the heavenly fields, before we reach the heavenly fields, so walk the golden streets, so walk the golden streets. We're marching to Zion,
and every tear be dry.
We're marching through Emmanuel's ground. We're marching through Emmanuel's ground to fairer worlds on high, to fairer worlds on high. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God.
Even though we have a heavenly kingdom, we sometimes get weary here on the journey. But the scripture gives us hope and encouragement along the way. Isaiah 40, 31. Those who hope in the Lord will gain new strength. They will mount up with wings like eagles. They will run and not be weary. They will walk and not faint.
Galatians 6, 9. Let us not lose heart in doing good, for in due time we shall reap if we do not grow weary.
2 Thessalonians 3:3. The Lord is faithful, and he will strengthen and protect you from the evil one.
2 Corinthians 12:9. My grace is sufficient for you, for power is perfected in weakness.
Nehemiah 8:12. Do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. Love one another that your joy may be full. And he's so gracious to help us do that. Let's sing our love to him.
I love.
Kids, it's just been great to have you in worship with us this morning. But now's a good time for you to go again through these south doors for the special time of worship just planned for you. Right through these doors to the right.
Hi, my name's Stan. I have 7 grandchildren. I don't know if you knew that or not, but that's some of the best stuff of life right there. So, I have a long history with Newberg Friends. Not as much personally, but because of the way that this group of people, God's people in this place, that gather in this place, have been a huge part of particularly my mom, Marcelle Crandall's life. And so it's a real joy to be with you today, and so grateful for all of you and the contributions that you have made in her life, and because of that, in my life as well. Just so you know, she loves you and she prays for you all the time. So that's a pretty good place to be, honestly. So I don't, you know, when Kenny and I were talking about how to get introduced, there's this title out there called Executive Director of Evangelical Friends Mission. And that's probably not only a little bit intimidating to me, but scary for lots of people who are out there. You know, titles can do that sometimes. And I haven't been in this job very long, about 7 weeks. And I have to just say, I'm so amazed at the response of God's people to Jesus' calling to the world. And I'm also so impressed with the quality of missionaries that God has raised up out of our churches across the United States to go and be ambassadors, really, for the kingdom of God around the world. And so it's really fun to be a part of this whole thing. And even as I am continuing on to sort of learn the job and stuff, there is sort of this interior awareness that this is not only, that this is a really good thing in terms of how God has worked in my life over the years. And I want to just tell you a quick little story that the Lord reminded me of as we were walking through the process of considering and being considered for this job. And it started really back in the early 90s. I was working with Chuck Mylander at the Evangelical Friends Church Southwest office, that region's director of new church development, starting new churches, and just had a real passion for how Jesus might be using God's people to move out and make disciples in places other than just their own community. And it was just this great thing, and there was a little bit of a sense that not only was that happening in the Southwest, but really around the United States. And so we had a conference, early 1990s, and it was in Atlanta, and we invited lots and lots of people who were interested in starting new churches to Atlanta to talk about how God might be doing that. And it was just an amazing time. We sensed God, you know, deepening our call to that whole thing. But because I had been one of the leaders, one of the people who helped put it together, I had to stick around an extra day and sort of tie up some loose ends. So everyone else had left, and I was flying home all by myself from Atlanta to Southern California. Got on a late flight. It was an all-nighter. And so as we took off from Atlanta that evening, looked out my window. This was back in the days when airplanes were sort of empty sometimes, and I had a whole row to myself, and I had a window seat, and I was looking out and was able to see all the lights of Atlanta, and it was beautiful. We took off, and we banked and turned west, and I think it was Nashville that we flew over next and saw all of those lights looking down, and that was just a beautiful and sort of moving sight. And as I sat there, every little bit I would look down, and pretty soon we were out over the mid part of our country, and I'd look down and I'd just see little patches of lights down there. Again, beautiful little oases of lights as we crossed the country, and every once in a while a big city. I think it was about the time that we flew over Phoenix, and I looked down and saw the quadrants. It's flat city. It's laid out in quadrants. I looked down and saw all of those lights, that the Lord turned that flight into a holy moment for me. Because in that moment, I realized every one of these lights is representing people who God loves. Every one of those lights represents someone who God loves and wants to impart his life to them, that Jesus died for. And as I looked across there, I just kind of found myself thinking, Lord, what would it take? What would it take for your people to actually move out and be a part of helping every single person represented by every single one of those million lights? What would it take for them to experience your love? And almost immediately, I got an impression from the Lord. That's kind of how the Lord talks to me sometimes, is through impressions. And got this impression from the Lord that was really clear, and it was just like, Stan, it'll take a movement of my people sort of getting outside of where they are, getting outside of their churches, and moving forward, making disciples. And that's how they're going to know my love, and that's how they're going to come and trust my love, to rely upon God's love. And in that moment, it struck me that really a movement, this sort of instantaneous, this sort of ongoing, combustible sort of movement of God's Spirit, it starts right here in each of our hearts. Now you see, EFM, Evangelical Friends Mission, we have a purpose statement. And a part of that purpose statement is that our greatest desire is to fuel a worldwide movement of God's people who move out, demonstrate the kingdom of God, come right here on earth just like it is in heaven, gather people who come to know Christ through that process into churches, and then take that message even beyond. And so that movement, it just realized, it starts when I, in my heart, it starts when you in your heart begin to understand that I can have a part of it. Not only can I do have a part of it. The whole place you might capture that is in the Great Commission. And when guys like me who represent sort of a missions movement preach, we often pull out this passage, don't we? I'm not telling you something you don't know. You've heard a sermon from the Great Commission many, many times. And you may have even heard someone say, the point of the Great Commission is love. The point of the Great Commission is to share God's love. It's to take this reality that God loves me, that I can know and rely on God's love, and that I can share that love with others, and as I share that love with others, they're going to experience God's love and perhaps even want to come to rely on it. The Great Commission is found in Matthew 28. Maybe you've heard it before. It's Jesus, the very last kinds of things he says, this last moment with his disciples. He says something, kind of in our last moments, we say some of the most important stuff, right? And so Jesus says, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of the nations, teaching them to obey, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I've taught you. And remember, I will be with you always. We hear that so often, and I was thinking, Lord, how do we capture that in a new way, or how do we hear it with new ears? And I began to think, I'm just going to write my own translation of this. And I'm not a Greek scholar particularly, I'm not a Greek scholar, and so if some of you are, if you want to. Talk about this more thoroughly later, we can. But the one key thing I want us to remember as you hear this Stan's translation is that word go, the literal translation from the Greek would be going. It's sort of this ongoing idea. going. And so my translation sounds something like this. Jesus says, I have been put in charge of everything you can imagine, both on heaven and on earth. Because of that, then, everywhere you go, help people to experience my love, to learn to know and rely on my love, and do it by training them up in the ways of the kingdom. And then immerse them as well in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And don't you ever, ever forget that I'm always with you. You see, the reason I like that translation, I suppose, is because it helps us understand that this making disciples idea, this going into the whole world idea, really isn't just for missionaries. It helps us understand that a movement just doesn't start out there, but that it starts right here. And that we can live it out every single place we go, that we can help people experience God's love, come to rely upon it. There's just a couple things that I think, if we're really going to live this out, that we need to remember. First of all, let's just talk real quickly about how do we help others experience God's love. Now, if we were to divide into little groups or, you know, have you raise your hands, you all would have ideas, perhaps, on how to do that. And I think that if we traced them, every one of your ideas back, it would come down to one single word, the word service. You see, in John 13, Jesus kind of told us, it says he showed us the full extent of his love. And it's John 13 is basically the start of the last three acts of Jesus' ministry, right? On John 13, he shows us what love is through the act of taking off his cloak, putting and girding himself up and washing the feet as a servant would of his disciples. That's how he shows his love, through service. And then a little bit later on in the Garden of Gethsemane, again, he shows us what love is through his submission to serve the Father in terms of going to the cross. And then there on the cross, he serves us best. He serves us most. He serves us most deeply through his crucifixion. And by the way, I am so grateful that that's not the end of the story, that there's this epilogue, right, where Jesus on the third day is raised up so that we not only can experience forgiveness of sins, that we not only can experience this lack of condemnation on God's part, his unconditional love, but then it allows us to experience his power so that all of a sudden we are aware that every single place we go, we get to share his love. I think it means so we ask the question everywhere we go, how can I serve? How can I serve you? We keep our eyes open for those people who need service everywhere around us. And that's how we show, we start with God's love, by service. And then as we're serving, we ask ourselves the question, in this moment, in my interactions with this person that I'm serving, where might God be in all of this? How might God be at work in their life? Sometimes we can even ask them that very same question. How is God at work in your life? How do you see God in all of this, even if it's a difficult situation? Because what that does is then opens them up to the possibility of experiencing God's love. And then finally, we can just ask the question, what do you want to do about that? How do you want to respond to God's movement towards you in your life? That allows them to step into a place where now all of a sudden they're not just experiencing God's love through our act of service, but now they're beginning to understand how, through responding to God's work in their life, they can obey, how they can begin to share God's love as well. And then just three other things, and then I want to tell a story and then show you a quick video. When it comes to this idea of sharing God's love, when it comes to this idea of making disciples, which, you know, all making disciples really means, it's a lot simpler than we sometimes make it. It just means helping others experience God's love. When it comes to that, it helps us to remember that God cares more about people than we do. God cares more about people around us experiencing his love than we do. And so we never have to walk around and worry about that. We can just know God loves these people, and I am in to helping them experience God's love. And that he's working in ways that we might not ever imagine. The second thing that we can remember is that if we will listen as we interact with people everywhere we go, if we will listen, God will guide us into the very best way to help them experience his love. We don't have to conjure anything up. We don't have to make it up. We actually don't even really need to be nervous. All we need to do is be attentive to God's work in our lives as we are dedicating ourselves to helping people experience God's love. And then finally, he is always at work in the lives of people around us, and he's at work in infinity ways, in more ways than we can ever imagine. You see, sometimes we think when it comes to making disciples, or when it comes to like that scariest word of ever, evangelism and all those kinds of words, sometimes we think, oh my goodness, we have to close the deal. Sometimes I take an airplane ride to Las Vegas, and when I get on the airplane, it's a 45-minute maximum ride. They don't even give you drinks. You know, they don't even have time to do that. And sometimes I'll get on a plane to Vegas to go visit one of our churches there. I really don't play the slots there. I'll get on the plane and I'll sit down with someone, and this whole sort of thought pattern will kick into my mind. Oh my goodness, I have to get to know this person, and I have to share Jesus with them before we land in 35 minutes, and they have to accept Jesus in those 35 minutes, because if they don't, they're in Las Vegas. And I know that what happens in Vegas really doesn't stay in Vegas. And I feel this big pressure inside of myself. And it's such a relief to think, you know what? God's at work in their life all the time in more ways than I can remember. And God is at work in their life even when they're in Las Vegas. So my job, go back to listening. Lord, how do you want me to demonstrate love to this person? And I'm so happy when I sit down, the person's already got their headphones on, you know, their eyes are closed. I'm not so happy, but it's kind of like, whew, no pressure there. Because there's no way I'm going to knock on their headphones, right, and say, hey, by the way, do you know Jesus? He's got a wonderful plan for your life. That's just not the way the Lord indicates it to me. But if I sit down and I pray for them, even if they're not interested in talking to me, I can be assured God's going to use that prayer. He's going to work in that person's life. God's at work in infinity ways. I don't always have to close the deal, because God loves them. He's on to that. So right before the pandemic and everything closed down, I was driving to the store one day, and I was having a little conversation with God. And like I said, I have these impressions of conversations with God. And I played sports, and one of the things that happens in sports sometimes is you rib one another a little bit, good-naturedly. And sometimes I feel like my conversations with God are good-natured. There's just a little good-naturedness going on in it. And so I'm driving along, and I kind of praying, and I say, I feel the Lord say, hey, Stan, remember that whole part where you want me to, where you tell people just to listen to me, you know, no matter what situation, and I'll guide them into what they want to do? Yeah, Lord, I know that. Yeah, I talk about that. He goes, yeah, let's practice that. And let's practice that as you go to the store. And I'm kind of going, I was hoping to get in and out. Okay, why do you want me to do? And I just felt like the Lord was impressing on me again before the pandemic, before we were wearing these. Lord kind of just, why don't you smile at everyone? And I'm pulling into the parking lot, and I'm going, yeah, that's a really bad idea. There's a couple of reasons why that's such a bad idea, Lord. The first one is, because I don't feel like smiling. I want to get in. I want to get out. I want to fly under the radar. I just don't feel like smiling. And then the second reason is because everyone in the store is going to think I'm creepy. And I'm pretty sure that's not the way of the kingdom. And so I had these reasons, and I just felt like the Lord said, okay, well, you asked me to, you know, impress upon you. I did. Now it's up to you. Are you going to respond? About to walk into the store, I kind of roll my eyes, and I kind of say, okay. Doors open. I step in. I put on a smile. Something really interesting hit me in that moment. It's like, why in the world wouldn't I want to smile? I mean, I just had this kind of interesting, fun back and forth with the king of the universe. That was pretty good. Why wouldn't I want to smile? I have everything I need to go into the store and get what I need, provided by the king of the universe. Why wouldn't I want to smile? And all of a sudden, the smile that was going to be inauthentic became very real. There's this joy that began to sort of bubble inside of me. But the real reason I didn't want to smile was still to be tested. So turn down the row, first row, see a woman coming towards me. Okay, here's my smile. Seriously, she did this. See, Lord, see. I told you it was creepy. She thinks I'm a creep. I just again felt the Lord kind of go, why don't you try again? Go around the corner and another person and just kind of a quick little smile, nothing more than that. Go around the next row and I see a mom, three preschoolers. The preschoolers are piled up inside of her cart and she is really intent on trying to figure something out. What does she need up there? So I go ahead and smile, and as I'm smiling, one of the little kids, you know, catches my eye and starts waving to me, hi. So I sort of wave back, and the mom, of course, saw that and looks at me, and it was just this moment where I sensed the Holy Spirit saying, talk to her. And so I just said, hey, how you doing? You have really cute kids, and I just want you to know that I think being a mother of preschool children is just like one of the hardest things ever. And, you know, your kids are well behaved. Really, congratulations. She said, thank you, big smile, and that was it. Go around, walk, you know, around. Everyone smiles back at me, get to the line. Or before that, there was a lady who wasn't too tall. She's trying to reach something, and so I just was able to help her get her stuff, whatever it was, and go to the line, look, you know, kind of like, kind of nerdy here. Catch the guy behind me, and he goes, hey, I got a question for you. I didn't initiate anything with him, but, you know, except a smile, and he goes, I got a question for you. My GPS doesn't know where this place is. Do you know where it is? Well, yeah, I do. And told him where it was, check out, nice to the cashier, she's nice to me, she gets paid to do that. And as I'm walking out the door, I kind of sense the Lord saying, hey, let's debrief this experience real quick. And I felt like the Lord was kind of laughing because he knew he was going to win. And just a quick question, Stan. Was that okay? Did you feel okay about that? Yeah, I did. And do you think the people that you interacted with felt okay about that? Yeah, I think they did. And why do you think that? Oh, I suppose people like people to be friendly. Uh-huh. And the mom? Yeah, I think she was encouraged. Yeah. Do you think in the kingdom of God, people are friendly? Yeah. Do you think that mom was encouraged? Yeah. And do you think I can take those little interactions, and though they might not have, you know, you might not have led them to a place of commitment to Christ right now. Do you think I can take all those little interactions and weave them together? Because by the way, I work in infinity ways at all the time in people's lives. Do you think I could weave that into something that might make them more open to my work later on during the day or even later on in their life? Yeah. So if we're going to get really, really picky, do you think that was one of those experiences where everywhere you went, you were able to help people experience God's love? Yeah. Okay. Just checking. And for the record, that was a disciple-making moment in your life. You might want to try it again sometime. I just tell that story just hopefully so that you will begin to understand that the way God wants to work in your life is to be a part of this movement. And a part of this movement is going to be helping everyone around you, whether they know Jesus or even if they do, experience God's love. But a part of it is understanding that when we love God here, it also allows God to be at work in the lives of people around us, and we have no idea the ramifications of that. One of my favorite things to remind people of is that we believe that the Lord wants to send out 10 new missionary households over the next 5 years to 5 new fields. We believe that. But one of the things I also have this conviction about is that some of those missionaries might not even be Christians today. And it's going to be because people like you are at work listening to the Lord, understanding that everywhere you go, you have the opportunity to help people experience God's love, to rely on it more deeply. And that some of those people very well may be, get to the point where they hear God saying to me, here am I, send me. And by the way, all being a missionary really is doing the kind of thing that we talked about, helping people experience God's love someplace other than in their own culture. That's all it is. And so when movement starts, a movement starts, it starts in our hearts because God does something with that. That's amazing. It's an expression of love. We're going to show a video here in just a second, and it's about the Luke 10 Project. And friends, churches from all over the United States have banded together again, with that desire that we believe that God is raising up within us this desire to send 10 missionary households to 5 new fields that we haven't even necessarily identified yet in the next 5 years. It's an exciting thing, and it's causing us to ask ourselves the question, okay, Lord, what do you want me to do? Let's just show that video real quick. It's 2 minutes long or so, and it'll give you a deeper idea.
1887, Esther Butler was the first missionary to be sent out by Evangelical Friends of North America. So it's through the efforts of these women that there are today Evangelical Friends in 36 countries on 5 continents.
Jesus commanded us to go into all the world and make disciples. For over 130 years, we've been doing that as Evangelical Friends. And we're committed to continuing that legacy through EFM.
I used to think that missions was something for our grandparents, you know, sending missionaries and pioneering new fields. I've been amazed to be places in a village where when we talked to people about Jesus, we found out through conversation that they had never heard of Jesus. Like they have never heard of Jesus, and now I recognize a great need to continue to send missionaries and to continue to pioneer new fields.
According to the Joshua Project, over 42% of the world's people groups are unreached, waiting for the gospel to be brought to them.
We look at our world today and we see how much need there is still for the gospel of Jesus Christ today, and we feel like to stay on mission, we need to send more missionaries. We need to open more new fields.
We have to continue to obey God's command to go. We have to continue to send our own sons and daughters, our own brothers and sisters, our own parents to go to the mission field.
The EFM board has embraced a new strategic goal to send out 10 new missionary households to launch 5 new fields in the next 5 years.
Would you partner with EFM in launching 5 new fields in the next 5 years?
We're looking for at least 10 new missionaries to join EFM in our goal. God uses all kinds of people to be missionaries. There's no one size fits all. There's no one particular gift set that God uses to be missionaries. And so it's possible that you, right now, maybe God is calling you to be a missionary. We're looking for families. We're looking for single men. We're looking for single women. We're looking for those who God has called to join us.
We as an EFM board need you and your churches to partner with us to reach this goal. What excites me the most is that there's going to be more disciples of Jesus who come to know him, whose eternities are changed.
That whole idea that Jesus ended the Great Commission with, and just remember, I'm with you always. The main reason, or one of the main reasons he wanted to say that to us, is so that we would always know we have immediate access to his spirit, immediate access to his voice, the voice of the Good Shepherd, who loves us and always leads us in the very best ways for us. And we believe that that reality is available to people all over the world, if they just know, and we want to be a part of that. Moreover, I believe that that reality is true in this moment, and that as we move into, I think we're going to move into a time of open worship, I believe that the Good Shepherd is speaking to some of us this morning, to all of us really, but perhaps some of us, about how they might be involved in the lives of those close to them, and the lives of those who are further away through partnership with Evangelical Friends Mission. Maybe by praying, maybe by going, certainly by sending. And the great joy that I have this morning is to invite you into that conversation with the living God, with the one who loves us most, with the Good Shepherd, Jesus. Even now.
really thankful for the message today. Something in a different way, but very related, has been on my heart this week. This is a wonderful mission field to hear about. I've had opportunities to just talk with people this week and hear where God is kind of leading them in different mission fields. Some are right here in our own community. And so really just being drawn close to the Lord, listening to those the voice inside, like Stan was talking about, kind of sometimes can be a fun dialogue, sometimes can be a scary dialogue where he's leading you and nudging you, but spending that time to listen to the Lord and follow where he's asking you to be his voice in the world around us, building bridges with those people that lots of people around us don't have a bridge built to them to just be introduced to God and come to him. So think about all these different opportunities to minister and to go into a mission field, and they can be right in our neighborhood.
When COVID struck, it had a pretty major impact on our missions effort here at Newberg Friends, and we basically had to lay it down for quite a long time. And so there's a few of us who have been really interested in wanting to get going again, to have a more emphasis on missions here at Newberg Friends. As you saw earlier, this coming Tuesday, 1 o'clock, right here, or down in the social hall, you're all invited to come, and if you have any interest at all in helping us promote missions more here at our church, this is not a commitment to become a member of the team or the go team or whatever it is you feel comfortable with calling it. If you just have an interest in helping us find ways to become more involved in missions in our church, welcome you to come.
Oh, just as I was listening to that story that Stan shared with us of his trip to the grocery store, I thought sharing the Lord, the love of the Lord with people costs us something. And it costs us something to share it with the people that are right around us. It also costs us to share it with people around the world. What does it cost us? It costs us setting aside our expectations, costs us setting aside our pride, it costs us setting aside fear and anxiety of what other people will think. It costs us even just that little thing inside of us that says, I want to do it my way. You know, I sometimes feel the same as Stan. I just want to get in and get out and just do what I came to do. I'm very task-oriented, and I don't necessarily want to take the time to pay attention to people. But we know that it cost Jesus something to save us from our sin. It cost him death. And if we're to imitate him, we need to die to ourselves. The same way that he literally died to save us. Sometimes people say, count the cost. We need to do that, but then we need to pay the cost. And it's not always easy. But because we have the Holy Spirit in us, we can make those sacrifices so that others might know the love of Jesus in their lives.
Just a quick little example of what she was talking about here. When you got up and said, does anybody need prayer? Nobody stood up. Does anybody know somebody who needs prayer? Well, we all know somebody who needs prayer, but how many of us stood up? And I didn't stand up, but my wife did, and she actually needs prayer, you know. And it took me a while to kick in to what is it that we're doing? You know, this morning I got a phone call from Congo, where we work, and there was a battle going on in a village 15 miles from our house. And the reports were all, everybody's running, they're all running and running. And then a while later, somebody wrote and said, one of the UN groups, the guys from Uruguay, actually were running to the battle. And it was just such an amazing, different feel that I had about the situation of what was going on. Everybody's running and panicking and everything, going away from the fight. But we need to be the kind of people who run to a fight. And this is what Stan is talking about. Be willing to get involved and go. That's my little bit for today. Okay.
Hello. Obviously, I'm not from here, and I wanted to say a little something about evangelism within your church. I walked in, and I was scared. You guys all seemed like you knew each other and like you've been here for a really long time, and there's this sense of belonging that you shared. And this is my first time, but you guys really welcomed me in and made me feel safe and made me feel like I could belong here, like you guys. And so I want to thank you for sharing the love that you have for God and for each other with me.
I just feel like a good way to close would be just to stand and sing this together. I think we know it without lyrics.
All to Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I will
trust Him
and trust Him
in His presence.
In His presence, daily live. And I surrender all. I surrender all. All to Thee, my
I just thought of what, Stan, what you said right at the beginning. You said of that story, you heard the Lord's voice. I think one of the greatest things is that we surrender our wills to the Lord's and we wait to hear his voice. And as we walk around in this world, even today, wherever you're headed, if we will stop and listen for the Holy Spirit's voice, he'll show us what to do. He'll show us how to love people around us the right way. And I just think that we have such a beautiful tool. It's that deposit of the Holy Spirit in us that will help us. We thank the Holy Spirit for that. And we thank the Lord that we have that today. So as you go today, just go as those who are walking in the Spirit and let the Lord lead you to love people around you. Man, I was in the store the other day just humming a worship song as I walked down the aisles, and the effect you felt just by someone humming, and then I was whistling, and just that effect of some joy and just bringing some life. So as you go today, and just be so kind to people, and especially those in the drive-up windows of restaurants, because they're working so hard and there's not very many people working there. I was at one yesterday, said, we will open up the inside of this restaurant when we get more workers. So just to be kind and to be loving and patient. So God bless you as you go today. Thank you so much, Stan, for bringing that word. Thank you for the worship team and for all of you for being here. God bless.